Shut the Box is an attractive, easy to play, fast paced game that can be played by a single person, or in this case, four people at one time. To play, you roll the dice, total them up, and then turn tiles over that match that total number. You can turn one or two tiles over. So there's two ways I could play this. I could turn a 10 over, or a 6 and a 4, 7 and 3, and so on. You play rolling and turning tiles over until you roll a number on the dice that you don't have tiles left standing that you can turn over. Then your game is done. The goal is to get all tiles turned over. In this game, if you do that, it's a perfect score of 55. That seems like an easy thing to do, but I've played 120 games and I've only had that happen to me once, so it's harder than it looks. There are many different ways and sets of rules to play Shut the Box. Originally, it was designed for a single player. You'd have one row of tiles and it would be held in a single box. If you got a perfect score, that's as good as you can do. The game is over and you'd shut the lid, hence the name. The game goes back as much as 800 years. And while, as I said, most versions are a single row of tiles in a box, they do come in larger setups like this, which allows four players to play as a parlor game or a table game. While there are many different ways of playing, different numbers of tiles, and some rules allow you to, when you get down to a certain number, just switch to rolling one dice, there are two basic categories of play. One is that you turn your tiles over and you add up the number of points that you turned over, and the high score, if you're playing with four people, the person with the highest score wins. More common way to play, though, is that you're rolling dice and turning tiles over, and you count the number of points left standing. The winner is the person with the lowest score, or the least number of points in their hand. One reason why the low score winning might be popular is that usually you'll get about 30 points on a game, so there's going to be less points to count up if you count the lowest score. There is a problem with this if you're trying to teach this game to young children, because they're used to sports like baseball, football, hockey, and soccer, where the high score always wins. So trying to explain to them that this is a case where the low score wins might be going a little uphill. I have found with my grandchildren that going with the high score wins makes it a lot easier and more intuitive for them. A typical game can be set up for, say, the first one who gets to 100 points. If you've got four players and they're rolling and adding it pretty good, that's about a 25-minute game, which is a nice length. And there's a lot of action because it keeps going around. Each turn is very quick. So all that's really nice, but the real question is there a strategy that increases your chances of, in this case, getting a high score or getting a low score if you prefer that way? And it turns out there is. I got interested in this game and I played three different strategies and about 30 games at each one. And I totaled up my scores and figured out my averages. And I found that one does work better than the other. One strategy is that as you roll, you aim to knock over the lowest number of tiles you can. For example, I could do this as a 9. Instead, I'll do it as a 5 and a 4. And I'll always work at trying to get rid of my lowest numbers first. Another strategy is the exact opposite, that you work on turning the highest tiles over first. This would seem to be the best option because these are the high point tiles, and so you should get higher average scores. The final one is a little tricky, and that is that you work at turning over as much as possible the middle tiles. The idea being that you're keeping your maximum flexibility because you have some highs and some lows left over. So which one works the best? To find out, I played 30 games of each strategy. My average for the 30 games I played on the tilt the low points over first was 23.2 points per game. My average for knocking over the middle ones first was 30.1 points. So knocking over the middles averages slightly higher than knocking over the low ones. But the clear winner was knocking over the high pointers first. With this strategy, my average for 30 games was 35.9 points. Now, 30 games in a dice type game is not enough to be statistically significant. However, the results are consistent enough that it is at least suggestive. So, if you want to increase your chances of winning or doing the best you can, whether you're doing the high score wins or low score wins, I recommend knocking over the highest tiles you can first, and you should do much better. Shut the Box is a great game. I have a lot of fun playing it as solitaire. I have a lot of fun playing with my wife and with my grandchildren, and they enjoy it too. A set like this, which is very attractive, ran $45 from Amazon in summer of 2017, which considering its construction, I mean, it's an attractive piece of equipment, well finished, and I think it's a great value because I've already gotten many hours of good play out of it. So I hope you'll give Shut the Box a chance, and as always, thank you for watching.